Welcome to MHM Podcast Network on MovieHouseMemories.com. Podcast for pod people. Our feature presentation begins now.
All right. It's time to talk about James Bond again. This is Male Bonding, where three guys, three very heterosexual guys, talk about one of their favorite subjects, James Bond films. And this week we're talking about Goldfinger. Once again, I'm Patrick Gard, and with me, as always, is the author of Duty, Honor, Empire, a 25th century love story?
Sure.
Okay, all right. Just want to make sure.
Is there a question mark on the cover? Or
Well, it depends what version you get, I guess.
You would think after all the times I've said it that I would know it better, but I always go, is it 24th century or 25th century? But it's a 25th century love story, and one of the co-hosts, my co-hosts on Movie House Memories, Chris Haley.
Hey, it's good to be here. I am a little bit embarrassed, though, because I'm coated in silver, not gold. I hope you don't notice.
The other co-host is also one of the co-hosts of Movie House Memories and also has appeared on Lunchtime Movie Review, the old podcast that we used to do a long time ago. Matt Palmer.
Hey, that's great. Could you guys hurry up? This laser is getting really close to my crotch.
Make sure you go through the summary quickly, which... It is now up to the summary of Goldfinger in 200 words or less. Matt, do you have it? Will the laser get to your crotch before you finish this summary?
Well, it depends on the temperature of the room, and it's cold in here, so we got a little extra time.
All right. Go ahead. Let us hear the summary of Goldfinger.
Can you tell me a story?
Goldfinger, it seems, has a lot of gold. In fact, he smuggles his gold across national borders and uses it to smother traitorous broads. The Brits send James Bond to keep an eye on him and Stoop his secretary. While spying and stooping, Bond catches wind of something Goldfinger calls Operation Grand Slam, which, contrary to Bond's intuition, does not involve four flight attendants and a bucket of baseballs. After a long and tragic car chase, Goldfinger catches Bond at a smuggling operation and decides to slice him in half with a laser beam. But Goldfinger changes his mind and decides instead to fly Bond out to Kentucky for some horse racing. Goldfinger's jet is piloted by Pussy Galore. They fly to Kentucky and put Bond in prison. He escapes and eavesdrops on Goldfinger's meeting with some mafiosos. It is here that Goldfinger lays bare his dastardly plot. They plan to gas all the military at Fort Knox and break in and steal all of the gold. Bond is wise to him, though, and it comes out that Goldfinger really wants to nuke the gold in Fort Knox so that his gold holdings skyrocket in value. To kick off the plan, Pussy Galore's team of stunt flyers spray deadly poison all over the fort, leaving it open to penetration. They break into the vault, and Goldfinger's henchman, Oddjob, handcuffs Bond to the nuke. But Pussy turned on Goldfinger. Turns out the poison gas they sprayed on the base was fake. The army wakes and fights Goldfinger's men. Meanwhile, Bond breaks free of his cuffs and bests Oddjob in a fight, stopping the bomb just in the nick of time, with the counter reading 007. When the scene is settled, Bond takes a flight to D.C. to meet the president, but Goldfinger hijacks the flight to settle the score with Bond. Goldfinger is killed when his gun discharges and the vacuum sucks him out of the plane. Bond, however, manages to parachute safely to the ground, where, waiting for him, there is Pussy Galore.
Well, wherever Bond goes, isn't there always Pussy Galore? All right, Goldfinger, A Christmas Present to the World, released on December 22nd of 1964, grossed just over $51 million in the United States, which, based off just that figure, makes it the 14th highest grossing film of the Bond series, right behind Living Daylights and right in front of A View to a Kill, which is just a sad place to be in the Bond films. However, if you adjust it for inflation, which we like to do, it would have made in the United States alone over $553 million, would make it the number two highest grossing James Bond film of the entire series, right behind Thunderball and right in front of Skyfall.
It's interesting that if you adjusted View to a Kill for inflation, it would be worth less today. I don't know how that works out.
Worldwide, it actually grossed in unadjusted dollars $124.9 million, so about a little over doubling what it did in the United States. It was based on the seventh novel in the James Bond book series. It was directed for the first time by Guy Hamilton after Terrence Young had directed the first two James Bond films. It was written by Richard Maybaum, made for a budget of only $3 million, but that which actually was a $1 million increase over From Russia with Love, which made its money back within 2 weeks of release, and was the first Bond film to ever win an Academy Award for Best Sound Effects. That was Goldfinger. All right. We've added another particular section here talking about the story of the film because Chris has a gripe about Goldfinger. He is unsatisfied with his film. Unlike Goldfinger, he finds no satisfaction. Chris, what is your gripe about the story of Goldfinger?
The gripe about the story of Goldfinger is that if you take James Bond out of this movie, it's just as good as without him. I don't think he does much in this film. I think that the plot is solved by Pussy Galore betraying Goldfinger. I think that the bomb was defused by somebody else other than James Bond. I will give him that he was able to not beat up the bad guy, but got lucky with electrocuting him to death. But really, I think you take James Bond out of this film, and it's just as solid.
False, my friend. False. I have to say false, because James Bond did the impossible in this film. He converted the lesbian to a straight way. And that is what caused Pussy Galore to give up Pussy Galore and turn to the side of James Bond and turn against Goldfinger. That is the crux of the film. That is all he essentially does, but it is so, so difficult. Only James Bond could have done it.
Do we know for sure that he did? She could have just been playing him to get what she wanted. We don't know if he really did woo her. I mean, all he did was judo throw her over his shoulder, and she's like, all right.
Okay, but they had, you know, they literally had a roll in the hay with a roll in the hay. So that's.
I want to back up a little bit. Did you just say that Pussy Galore gave up Pussy Galore?
Yes. That joke's never going to go. We're going to take Pussy Galore so much in this.
But are we going to have a giggle counter every time one of us says Pussy Galore for this podcast?
Yes.
She doesn't double-cross Goldfinger without Bond, you know.
Stooping her, as you like to say.
literally setting her straight.
Well, and that's kind of one thing we hadn't even talked about. We're not saying Honor Blackman was a lesbian. But the character of Pussy Galore in the book was actually a lesbian that he converts, that he persuades to join his side by his manly ways. That's actually the story of Goldfinger. It's not explicitly stated in the film, but there's something about Honor Blackman that always struck me as lesbian. Well, for some.
She does like her fellow pilots. I think it was a pretty strong hint that she went that way in this film.
Yeah, I think it's a very, very strong hit. Matt, did you get that impression?
She was awfully manly. So, I don't think I ever went lesbian, but I went, she's not your typical Bond girl. And I guess that's because your typical Bond girl is into dudes.
Well, your typical Bond girl kind of falls head over heels for James Bond just by him walking into the room, and Pussy Galore really could care less about him. And I'm not even convinced that he got her to change her mind to betray Goldfinger. I think she was just smart enough to realize, with the example set by the killing off of the gangsters and what was her name, Jill at the beginning?
Jill Masterson.
That she knew that as soon as Goldfinger got what he wanted, he was going to kill off any witnesses, which means her and her beloved female pilots. So I think she betrayed him for her own good, not because James Bond stooped her in the hay.
No, I say it's James Bond's dick that's the most important thing in this entire film.
Well, that the gold member of this film, but
wait, what about can you either explain to me why everyone has to fake like they're dead long enough for them to arm a nuclear weapon, you know, just down the road?
Well, they had to make sure it was there. So they are waiting till the Geiger counter said that they flown in, because they flew it in by helicopter. They didn't roll it in on the truck, correct?
Okay.
Am I correct in that?
No, I think they did, but it still seems strange that it's like, all right, go put it in the vault and arm it, and only then we will spring forth.
Wait till they're right there in our clutches.
If you paid attention to the gunfight, they really weren't tactically trained very well either.
No, let's all run out in the open and shoot.
I was expecting some of the guys to just be yelling "we" the whole time as they shot things.
All right, let's talk about the music. Let's get on to Chris's first section. The music in this film. Chris, one of the first time that the Bond theme is used in the opening credits.
Yeah, the first time. And, you know, I say all the time that a first time sets a precedence and the second time sets the standard. And even though From Russia with Love did have a theme song for it, I think that Shirley Bassey's version of this, along with the opening sequence, just absolutely killed it for all future Bonds. It definitely set the standard for what would come for years and years. It's just I think one of the best Bond openings ever.
The credits, as far as the song or the opening pre-title sequence?
Everything, the opening song and, you know, just the Goldfinger.
Well, definitely iconic, I would say.
Yes. No, I think it's just an even great song. So this movie starts with that, and I think that's what sets it as one of the best Bond films, even though there's some silly plot holes. But this music really set the whole, what would you say? It set the whole tone for the movie.
Shirley Bassey's song was, I believe, the first Bond theme nominated for an Oscar. I think it was, if it wasn't number one, it was in the top 10. It was a hit in itself.
Yeah.
You know, shit, I even remember my dad, when I grew up, this was my first exposure to James Bond, was that album, because my dad had the soundtrack album on LP. And the picture of the woman painted gold on the cover kind of drew my attention, and that's what eventually caused him to introduce the Bond series to me. But this was that he had this album, and I asked him about it. I didn't like the song back then. I still don't like it now, but I do understand why a lot of people do like it. It does set the standard for the Bond themes from this point forward.
Mm-hmm. And she did a couple others after that, I think, too.
Yeah, some of my least favorite, Diamonds Are Forever and Moonraker. But John Barry does the score to this film again.
Again, forever, for how many films?
Yeah, he does them for a while. So
yeah,
probably John Barry does them until we tell you differently. So
yeah, and I think he's pretty much besides doing the score, I think he was pretty much responsible for the whole opening, wasn't it?
What do you mean the whole opening?
Like the whole beginning sequence, the
pre-credit sequence.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
even the credit sequence. Did he do the credit sequence too?
Yeah, he did the entire score.
Yeah, yeah, the whole thing.
Yeah, usually they do.
Yeah, go team, go.
And I'm the only one having an adult beverage this evening. So, Matt, you want to talk to us about? Well, let's talk about some gadgets, because this is the film that brings the gadgets for the first time.
Yeah, we got some gadgets. Well, I guess really you got that very iconic. You know, and this is the first really overly complicated Bond death sequence we've seen, or attempted death sequence, where you have that gigantic laser slowly inching toward his ding-a-ling.
Yes, his other gadget, the gadget that is the crux of this entire plot.
The ultimate Bond gadget. So you've got that, and you could probably stop there, because it's just... that's what you think of when you think of Bond, is the unnecessarily complicated, you know, attempt to kill him that takes forever. You have his Aston Martin in
the DB5, the iconic car of the James Bond series.
And it's loaded, you know, it's got the escape features, it's got the machine gun. So two of the bigger, more iconic Bond gadgets. I thought it was interesting how Goldfinger's lair was kind of gadgety in a very old-fashioned way. He had that scale model of everything that just kind of felt kind of cool, you know, kind of felt a little over the top. Action sequences, the big car chase scene, I just thought was too much, way too much. It was just dragged on, and at times seemed a little absurd. I wasn't terribly impressed with that. We already kind of talked about the big fight sequence at the end, which also was absurd. It, you know, guys walking around and machine gun fire. It's just horrible, really.
Would we consider Oddjob's hat a gadget?
Yes. I would consider that a gadget.
Yeah, that's a good call.
because that's a pretty stiff brim he's got there. Although those ancient Chinese secrets.
The big climactic fight with Bond and Oddjob, I will rate more highly. That's probably one of my favorite Bond moments of the three movies we've seen so far. So that gets good marks, but really the action sequences and the rest of this movie are well they're bad. Let's just leave it that way.
I don't know if they're bad. I think that other than the guy standing out in the open shooting guns at the end of the film, I agree with you. The battle in Fort Knox between Oddjob and Bond is one of the better battles between Bond and a henchman or even a main villain than the fact that Bond can't overpower this guy. He's got to outthink him. And I like the way that one came out. I don't like it when Bond just overpowers someone or, you know, gets the better of them in some ridiculously stupid way.
There's no way that Bond was able to kill Oddjob one-on-one if he wasn't able to outwit him in some way.
Were you guys bored with the car chase?
Which one? The one where the girl is honking at him or the one at night where he's got, is their name Tilly? Where he's got Tilly in the car with him?
At night, the one at the smuggling operation. I just thought it was too long.
You're talking about when he's on Goldfinger's grounds?
Yeah.
And eventually runs into the wall?
And they capture him anyway.
Yeah, they capture him anyway, but it's very anticlimactic. After he's already been captured once, that I saw that as, hey, this is just a way that we can show off some of the gadgets of the car. We can show the ejector seat and eject this guy out and show the DB5 and a little more in action, so to say. I thought it was anticlimactic to have him just, oh, he sees a mirror and he runs into a wall by accident, you know.
I think they were trying to sell some toy tie-ins during that scene.
Well, they're trying to sell a lot during this film. So,
well, was that a thing back then? Were they really marketing towards the toys the way they do now?
I think it came out of that. I don't think that was necessarily their intention, but there is a lot of product placement. You see it at KFC or Kentucky Fried Chicken in the background of the scenes, in some of the scenes where they're in Kentucky. I'm trying to think of some of the other things, but it's very much product placement in there that they got a small percentage, not probably as much as they would get today to do something like that. It's not like they drove through a truck carrying a whole bunch of Perrier bottles like they do in GoldenEye, but they definitely had some sort of product placement in here to help finance the film. I'm trying to think, is there any other gadgets in this film that, what did Q give him at the beginning besides the DB5? Oh, we gave him the little radio transmitter.
The big one and then the little one? Is that what it was?
The big one and then the little one. And he puts it in the gangster's pocket, who then gets crushed. This film is, you kind of start setting the standard as far as gadgets. This is one of the more, there was a couple of gadgets in From Russia with Love. There's very few gadgets in Dr. No, but this is the gadget film. And I mean, what part of my research is this film is kind of the template for the rest of the Bond films. This is the first time the pre-title sequence has nothing to do with the main story. It's just another adventure of James Bond, which I kind of like. You get to see him doing something else. And you have the Bond theme, you have the Bond gadgets, Bond girl. We'll talk about them in a second, but there's a lot that you see used repeatedly going forward in the remainder of the Bond films.
Well, I think it's that what we think of as those gadgets that kind of stretch the genre almost into sci-fi just a little bit. You know, you're not going to call it a science fiction movie, but they just kind of start making stuff up.
Yeah, I wonder if there's someone in 1964 like me who was looking at the laser and calling bullshit the same way when I saw Die Another Day and they had an invisible car. And Wonder Woman?
Well, she had an invisible plane, so maybe she...
No. But this film is not, as Matt kind of said, this film isn't full of action sequences. There's a lot of talkie-talkie through this and a lot of setup towards the ultimate battle at the end. Even the action sequences earlier in the film are very small.
In terms of talking, actually, you know, a lot of times you'll catch the villain monologuing, which Goldfinger definitely does, but when Bond is underneath the laser... I forget the exact quote, but Goldfinger says, "No, I expect you to die." I think that's one of the best lines out of a villain. It's not like I'm going to do something. Well, I guess he kind of did end up doing something stupid by setting him free. But I think that Goldfinger actually, through his talking and his actions, actually showed some intelligence more than some of the other criminals in the two previous Bond films.
True. But even still, it's not so much a take over the world type of agenda, which a lot of the remaining Bond films, but it is a very much an over-the-top plot that his ambition is pretty ambitious in this film. Although in the book, he's just trying to steal the gold. In this film, I think the way they converted it for the film is a much, much, much better story and much more believable. Because I think they address that issue. Bond's like, it would take you like 12, you know, it would take you 2 weeks to haul all the gold out of there. And they're not going to sit around and let you do that. So it makes
I don't think those troops could play dead that long.
No. Let's talk about some Bond girls, shall we? We've already kind of talked about Pussy Galore, Honor Blackman. To this point in time, she is the oldest Bond girl ever at 37. So, you know, in 1960, that's a little over the hill, although younger than Sean Connery at that point in time. I did find something interesting that they had went back and forth about changing her name to Kitty Galore. In the book, it's Pussy Galore, but they were thinking about doing it Kitty Galore, obviously for the same reason that we keep joking like we're in junior high. But it was the director, Guy Hamilton, decided that, you know, and the quote was, if you were a 10-year-old boy and you knew what the name meant, you weren't a 10-year-old boy, you were a dirty little bitch.
You know, Dirty Little Bitch would have been a pretty good name for her.
So I thought that was a funny line. It's like, you know, it is what it is. That's the reason that we want to use the name. Mm-hmm. But Pussy Galore, Bond slept with, obviously we've talked about it, his magic gadget turned her over to the straight side and converted her to the side of good.
I'm still not convinced of that.
Okay, you can keep arguing.
I think she was too smart for him, and she just did what she had to do to get what she wanted.
Okay, I disagree with you. I think Matt agrees with me. Matt likes his magic gadget, so... Well, we had Jill Masterson, played by Shirley Eaton. She's the girl at the beginning of the film helping Goldfinger out, the one who dies by being painted gold, which apparently you can't die from being painted gold. That was just a creation of the film. Her sister, Tilly Masterson, played by Tania Mallet, who tried to get revenge on Goldfinger and got hit with Oddjob's hat, and I assume broke her neck. That seemed to be the implication. And the last Bond girl I had was Dink. That's played by Margaret Nolan. That was Bond's masseuse at the very beginning of the film. The one says, Dink meet Felix. Felix meet Dink, you know, and then tells her to go away. I put her in there because of one, I thought that was a funny line, but also she's the one who dances in the opening credit sequence. She's actually got more screen time than Shirley Eaton, who played Jill Masterson. Of the Bond girls, Bond only sleeps with two in this one. It's kind of not a very active film for him. He sleeps with Jill Masterson, and then he sleeps with Pussy Galore.
Because that prick Goldfinger kills him off before he gets a chance. Going that way with Jill.
True. And I'm sure somewhere off scene, he probably slept with Dink too. But on screen, we only saw him sleep with two. Although he got Pussy twice. So, well, not just Jill and Pussy, but Pussy Galore twice. So... of the Bond girls.
You're very proud of that.
Come on. I'm not going to have this much fun making fun of one of the characters' names until we get to Plenty O'Toole and Diamonds Are Forever or Dr. Goodhead and Moonrakers.
Wait, what does that mean?
Of the Bond girls, who is your favorite of the film?
I liked Pussy Galore because she wasn't the typical Bond girl. She didn't fall head over heels for James Bond. He actually had to work for that one.
Okay, Matt?
Oh, it's definitely Pussy Galore. Although I think the way she played the role at times, you know, the way it was acted was a little grating at times. But yeah, she's definitely the Bond girl in this movie.
Well, that makes it unanimous because she is the Bond girl of this film. As much as I don't really care for Honor Blackman, and I don't really care that much for the Pussy Galore character, there's no really female character in this film that really has enough screen time to do anything else. Jill Masterson is killed after like one or two scenes. Tilly Masterson is killed after one or two scenes. And Dink basically just gives them a back rub. So it's really hard to say that, oh, she's the iconic Bond girl of this film. But I agree.
But in a way, she is the Bond girl of all Bond girls, because we've already joked several times in this podcast about how, you know, all these women need to get right is a good shagging from James Bond. And, you know, so potent are his abilities that he can completely turn her over. So much so that before she wouldn't even look at him that way. And now she's double crossing her boss just because she's so enamored by, you know, what he put on her.
Well, remember, Chris doesn't believe that.
I do not.
All right, what about kills in this film, Chris? What Bond kills, or what kills does Bond have?
He has a few.
Well, then he didn't do anything now, because I say he's got one good kill that he nailed Pussy Galore.
He killed that in 007 seconds.
He's James Bond, not Rick Pitino.
He was in Kentucky. The first one was at the beginning. He killed the man in the tub with an electric fan. There's a lot of electrocuting in this one by James Bond. Kind of bookended this whole film.
James Bond teaches the kids the dangers of electricity. That's what
he does. And in James Bond's own words, shocking, positively shocking. So that was the first one. The guy got it in the tub. Next kill in the movie was Odd Job. He was the shit kicker in this film. He, of course, painted Jill gold. Then next was James Bond again. I'm going to assume these Asian guys were Korean, since Odd Job was Korean. So I'm just going to refer to them as that. And the three guys in the car went over from the oil slick. That was very, very Looney Tunes. I think the Roadrunner stuck its tongue out as the guys went over the cliff.
So three guys in the car. So Bond's got four to Odd Job to one at this point.
He's got four to one. And then there was another Korean guy in the gunfight. So we'll put him at five. Then next, Odd Job took out Tilly with the hat to the face, to the neck, which wherever. It was kind of a wimpy throw too, by the way. It was just kind of like it bonked her and she's like, oh, I'm falling over. Next, Bond took out another Korean guy in, I'm assuming he was dead. He was in the passenger seat and got ejected out of the top.
Oh, he didn't get killed.
You know?
I don't think he got killed.
I think you got to assume it just because of the kind of movie it is.
They
I think
killed?
Odd Job can kill a girl with a hat. Bond can kill a guy with a chair, with a car seat.
Yeah, but he only went up in the air like 10 feet and then came down. I mean, he may have broke a leg, may have gotten a bruise, but I don't think he died.
Yeah. Oh, we got to think he died.
Oh, you guys are being generous.
Bond gave him a severe butt bruise, that's for sure. I bet that's what he landed on that tailbone.
Hey, he's turning him the other way.
Well, Bond will set him straight. Let's see. Next was possibly the most impressive of Bond's feats in this whole film, and that's even turning a lesbian straight. And that's when he took out the Korean guy in the cell with his magic levitation act. Then Odd Job starts killing again. He killed the gangster in the car, and he crushing his beautiful little gold vehicle and melted it down.
Okay. So Odd Job's three to Bond's seven?
Yeah, but they're all extras. They're guys wearing the red shirts when Kirk goes down to the planet. Yeah. It's throwaway guys.
Yeah, well, that's the way it goes sometimes.
Next, Goldfinger starts racking up the kills when he kills the very highly trained GIs that were faking their deaths. I forget how many Goldfinger took out.
Oh, too many to list. There's a lot there.
I don't remember when. Didn't Goldfinger kill the Asian, the Chinese guy? What was his name? Mr. Ling? Mr. Wong?
Yeah.
I didn't write down if he came next or if Odd Job killed the guy trying to turn off the bomb.
Odd Job. I think Odd Job killed him first, because I think the door shuts before that guy Goldfinger kills the scientist. Okay.
So Odd Job killed the villain, and Bond started getting his ass whooped by Odd Job, but was able to dodge the vicious hat, because those Brits are known to be able to dodge a good hat here. And he did end up electrocuting Oddjob. And then after someone else saves the day by defusing the nuclear bomb, Bond was able to shoot out the window in the plane, and Goldfinger's large butt gets sucked out through it. So what are the kills? How many did he get? 1, 5. I'm saying he killed the guy in the car. 6, 7, 8. Bond killed eight.
And
if he didn't kill the guy in the car, he killed 007 men.
Well, see, that's a nice round number, 7. See, I think it's it's very poetic. They go out of their way to make sure the timer stops at 007. So
I will give you that. I do like poetic things like that.
So he killed 7. The guy in the car lives. He lived, went on to be a henchman for Largo in Thunderball, the next Bond film. All right, so let's talk about the villain in this film. We've got the main villain of Goldfinger, but we also got two henchmen. That's Oddjob and Pussy Galore. Matt and I like to think Pussy saw the light and came to the light side, and Chris likes to think that she's on her own agenda. You know, that you know they can't be turned. It's a lifestyle. It's not a choice.
She was too smart for him, I'm telling you.
What did you guys ultimately think of Goldfinger in this film? Let's start with the main guy, Goldfinger, Matt.
You know, what I liked that his ambitions, like you said, they're over the top, but they're a little more believable than world domination and, you know, Spectre and all that stuff. So I kind of liked that it was really just in the end kind of a heist movie. Although a very creative and original one. I like that. In a way, though, it kind of took away from the idea of the how much we like to see James Bond foil the people who are going to take over the world. It kind of seemed beneath Bond to be foiling a heist.
Oh, man, are you going to be disappointed in License to Kill when he takes on the drug dealers?
Well, I think that what I did like about him was that he was a pretty smart guy, and he did have a much more rounded out plan. I mean, yes, it was absurd that he was going to nuke this, but I thought it was more thought out, and I thought he was a better villain simply because I don't think he could have done a lot of this stuff by himself, so he had to hire people, and half of his time was carrying this plot through. The other half really was killing off the people who helped him complete certain parts, you know, as seen by the gangsters. So, and which also leads to me thinking that Pussy Galore would have been killed off by him. So I did like that he was a complete dick throughout, and that he was ruthless. And in the end, I think, like when Dr. No died, I'm like, ah, big deal. There wasn't really any satisfaction. He kind of seemed like an idiot to me. When Goldfinger died, I'm like, yeah, he did get what he deserved because he had no real redeeming qualities.
Well, I like Goldfinger as far as the villain. One, because he doesn't have a lot of the Dr. Evil moments that we've talked about before. That, as Matt kind of talked about, he's going to kill Bond. Granted, some elaborate way with a laser and everything like that, but he's not explaining his entire plot. He doesn't sit there and tell him this is what I was going to do, but now it doesn't matter because you're about to die type of situation. In fact, he kind of pokes at Bond saying, you think you know what's going on and you're just trying to buy time. But ultimately Bond's able to convince him that I'm worth more alive right now than dead. But it was a very interesting. I mean, Bond didn't get his way out of that as far as tricking, you know, as far as like buying time so he could get loose of his bindings. He talked his way out of it. He used his wits, and I thought that was a good sequence. And although I don't understand why he doesn't just kill Bond later in the film right away when they're on their way to go to, you know, Fort Knox, why take him there and put him in the actual vault, so to say, that would only give him the opportunity to stop. You know, I'm going to tie you to this bomb that you could possibly disarm. You know, just going to give you the chance. If you're smart enough to do it, you can turn off the bomb, and that would just ruin my plans entirely. But what about the henchmen? We got two, Oddjob, and I would say Pussy Galore is a henchwoman in this film. She's an employee of Goldfinger, and throughout most of the film, she's kind of against Bond, you know, making sure he stays, you know, locked up or secured, or is giving the impression to the CIA that Bond's there willingly. Matt.
She's just a Bond girl waiting to happen. She's not a henchman. She's just confused.
I think that Goldfinger knows Bond's secret weakness, and he got what he wanted from Bond because of Pussy Galore. So I think, yeah, she was a complete henchwoman.
Okay. Do you like her?
I did like her, yeah. Yeah. Right. Like I said, I she's definitely the smartest of the Bond girls thus far. Well, I would even put her intelligence on par with Goldfinger and Bond's, maybe even higher.
What about Oddjob?
Oddjob is an iconic henchman. I love it. You know, he's eccentric. He's very difficult to defeat. He seemingly has no weakness. It's this great task for Bond to overcome. Like you guys said, he has to find a way to outwit him, and it's otherwise hopeless. I think Oddjob is you know, like the laser, like the gadgets and all this stuff, is one of those iconic James Bond images to come out of this. I think he's perfect.
Yeah, if you were to ask me to name two villains from any Bond film off the top of my head, Oddjob is first and Jaws is second. I don't think you can really get much better. I mean, of course, they didn't say much, but I think that they are, especially Oddjob, is just perfect for the villain role for James Bond. Clearly, James Bond was no match for him strength-wise, and it forced him to use his wits to defeat him. So Oddjob's a great, great villain.
You guys realize that Harold Sakata, the actor who played Oddjob, was badly burned during the electrocution scene?
Yeah, I had read that he got badly burned, but played it out still because he knew how important it was. So
he earned it.
Yep. And he went on to a very long and lucrative film career of basically playing the same part in television commercials and, you know, variety shows for the remainder of his life.
I hope they didn't make him get burned after each take.
No, they did not.
That's good. Trying to recreate the magic.
All right. Well, let's wrap this up. What do we ultimately think of Goldfinger?
It's a good movie. It's not the best of the Bond movies we've seen so far.
Really? Which one do you think is? Do you think they're all better, or which one do you think is better?
If I had to rank them, I might go from Russia with Love, Dr. No, Goldfinger.
So this is your least favorite of the three we reviewed so far.
Yes, but I'm still calling it a good movie that I enjoyed watching.
Okay.
I just the fact that it kind of comes down to a heist movie to me diminishes it somewhat as a Bond movie.
Interesting.
Well, I'm going to go the exact opposite. This is my favorite so far of what we've seen. I will say that I have problems, as I was complaining with at the beginning, that yes, you can take Bond out of this film, and I think it's just as solid of a movie, but this is still a very solid movie regardless, and it still has my favorite villain of Oddjob in it. It's got a very smart Bond girl. It's got a great opening sequence, and Bond doesn't take out somebody like Dr. No in 2 seconds. I mean, he had to work to defeat this villain.
You know, I'm going to agree with Chris on most of what he said, but I'll even go further that not only do I think this is the best we've reviewed so far, I think Goldfinger ultimately is the best of the Sean Connery Bond films. It is my favorite of the Sean Connery. It's close there with From Russia with Love, but I like this one a little bit better. And for a lot of the reasons that Matt doesn't like it is that I like the fact that it's not Spectre-driven. I like the fact that it's a different adventure of, you know, James Bond, that it is not just tied to, you know, the whole Spectre organization like the first two films are and the remainder of the Sean Connery films are. That is what I like about it, is that it's a little bit different. I like that it's a little bit of a heist film, a little bit more elaborate of a heist film, but that's what I like about it. But I also, one of the reasons I like it is that this film is just, I think this is what establishes the film as the James Bond series as a phenomenon and so much is there, the pre-title sequence, the opening theme song, even the opening credits are now we're really starting to see Maurice Binder's opening credit designs, where you're going to see a lot more naked women and the credits being shown on naked bodies and things like that. Something that followed the series well into the 90s, that is just was one of the staples of the series. And just so much starts with this film, even the amount of gadgets in this film. Granted, some of them are a little bit over the top, but that's always something that happens in the Bond films. But I think this allows the Bond film to become the global phenomenon that it ultimately becomes. All right, that does it for this month's review of Goldfinger. Thanks once again for joining us and listening to our little monthly podcast as the three of us boys get together and get rid of Lori, and we talk about some of the films that boys like to watch. So if you've had a good time, the fun doesn't have to stop here. You can follow us on Facebook at Movie House Memories or on Twitter at MH Memories on either Facebook or Twitter. You can keep up on our written film reviews, news on upcoming films and Blu-ray releases, and information on upcoming podcasts. Also, if you've enjoyed yourselves and download us off iTunes, make sure to rate our podcast on iTunes. And if you have a chance, write a short review of the podcast. Of course, we always like the reviews that are positive, but we appreciate any feedback that we can get from the fans of the show, even those who want to correct me when I'm wrong about the books I haven't read for a decade or so. And if you're a fan of the show, help us keep it going. If you're considering making a purchase through Amazon.com, come to our site first at moviehousememories.com. Click on any one of the Amazon banners there, then do your shopping, and then do your checkout. And that's as simple as that. A portion of your purchase goes to us to help us keep the upkeep and the bandwidth expenses that we get with the various different podcasts that we're doing now to help offset those expenses. And it doesn't cost you a single penny. Just Amazon pays us as basically being kind of an advertiser for them. You can buy, as always, you can buy the Bond 50th anniversary or Blu-ray collection, which is how I watch the Bond films every month, which I still highly recommend to anybody who's not only just a Bond fan, but a film fan. It is well worth the money that you spend on it. The last time I checked, it was at $129, and that included all 22 Bond films. Does not include Never Say Never Again, because that's not really a Bond film, but we'll talk about that later. And that is it for this month's episode of Goldfinger. Join us next month when we review the fourth Bond film, Thunderball, also with Sean Connery. And don't forget to check out our other podcast, the podcast where the three of us are joined by the lovely Lori Flores, Movie House Memories. Listen in on June 15th for our next new episode, where we review Lawrence of Arabia, one of my picks as one of the 100 greatest films of all time. So, all right. Well, that is it for this month's episode of Male Bonding. Until next time, I'm Patrick.
I'm Chris.
I'm Matt.
And we'll see you next time at our house. This podcast is not endorsed by Eon Productions and Sony Pictures Home Entertainment and is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. James Bond, all names and sounds of James Bond characters, and any other James Bond-related items are registered trademarks and or copyrights of Eon Productions and Sony Pictures Home Entertainment, or their respective trademark and or copyright holders. All original content of this podcast is intellectual property of MHM Podcast Network, Movie House Memories, and Fuzzy Bunny Slippers Entertainment, LLC, unless otherwise noted.